Believe it or not, this was the very first televised pay-per-view event, the Pennsylvania Polka Festival. What major cable network made history by airing the festival in 1973? We'll have the answer later in this edition of 3.
The Home Box Office is presenting the Pennsylvania Polka Festival in cooperation with Service Electric Company for the next 3 hours.
Now I got something to say now. Remind me to say this, something that I got right here. No. Okay, thank you.
Your appetite at the snack bar. Extra special good hamburgers, wonderful donuts, ice cold fist crunching drinks. Pizza generously sliced, steaming hot, fresh coffee, ice cream in many flavors. It's showtime, folks. Enjoy the show.
Because it's getting 10-2 now.
Friday, a garbage man from Cleveland, Latin Spitfire Googie Gomez, and a gang of Midwest mafiosi are just a few of the characters you'll encounter in Richard Lester's hilarious Night at the Baths. Don't miss The Ritz, starring Rita Moreno and Jack Weston. The Ritz, it'll turn an ordinary scrub-up into an outrageous experience. Premiering Friday. David Essex stars in a backstage look at the meteoric rise and tragic downfall of an international rock idol, Stardust. Then, John Mills and David Burney uncover a series of bizarre murders done in 12th century style in Dirty Night's Work, Saturday. Sunday, Peter Finch and Faye Dunaway head a star-studded cast in Patty Chayefsky's outrageous and tragic comic vision of the TV industry, Network, winner of 4 Oscars and premiering Sunday for the first time on television.
Watching Home Box Office.
The story that was a billion years in the making of a boy, a girl, and a universe. One of the most dazzling entertainments of all time. Star Wars, next.
The most memorable moments in and out of the ring. Friday, February 11th.
Enjoy 24-hour-a-day entertainment. Here on HBO.
The following feature has been rated PG by the Motion Picture Association of America. Parental guidance is suggested.
Performance rallying, one of the most difficult motorsports in the world, made even more difficult in the snow. The Sports Car Club of America's Pro Rally Championship begins each season with a winter rally. Rally teams concentrate their efforts on a tire choice for the wide range of winter conditions. But this year, there's water and mud to deal with as well. This is the SCCA Pro Rally Championship. I'm your host, Russ Rosendale. The Pro Rally season kicks off with the Snowdrift Rally, centered in Atlanta, Michigan. With the new season comes a new lineup for some teams, as well as new teams joining for the entire series. Mitsubishi's now backing a two-car effort headed by Reese Millen and an open-class Lancer Evo, with a Group 2 Lancer for Lachlan O'Sullivan. Paul Schwanier returns to Hyundai, but with two new team members for this event. Frank Sprongle, former Canadian champion and snow expert, will be piloting a Hyundai Elantra, while British champion Mark Higgins makes his U.S. debut aboard a Hyundai Tiburon. His brother David Higgins will be contesting the championship in a privately entered Subaru. Subaru Rally Team USA is back, but with last year's rookie sensation Ramin Alagamin as the team's second driver in an open-class car. Those are mighty big shoes to fill for a driver with only 15 rallies on his record. Last year's champion Mark Lovell returns to defend his title and had the dubious honor of starting first on the road. The first leg of the Snowdrift Rally consists of five stages, two south of Atlanta, then one north of town, a quick service after which the first two stages are run again in the dark. Total distance for leg one is 106 miles. Mitsubishi's John Everett told us about his company's involvement for the year.
Well, we're really excited with Mitsubishi Rally Team USA. We have a factory-backed effort with Mitsubishi Motor Sales of America. It's a first for this season where we have an actual works-backed Group 2 Lancer. It's a Lancer production vehicle, and we're excited about that with Lachlan O'Sullivan leading it up in the driver's position, co-driver with Matt Chester. Also moving into the open category is Reese Millen. He's an exceptional driver. We're really proud of what he's done for Mitsubishi at Pikes Peak and also with all the performances in 2001. So we're looking for between Lachlan and Reese Millen, and also with Millen's co-driver Gary Cowan. Hopefully we can garner a manufacturer's championship this year. And it's going to be a fun challenge with Subaru and Hyundai. They're great competitors, and this is a great series.
When most people decide to go racing in the SCCA, they look at all the different classes the SCCA has to offer. But what Joe Gaudette did is he just looked right into his garage where he found this beautiful red Corvette Z06. How'd you make the transition to decide to drive your street car?
Yeah, I just decided one day after doing a lot of driving events that I was going to go racing with the SCCA. I caged the car and brought it up to T1 specs and decided I was going to dive right in head first.
Now, over the course of the year, you had to get to the runoffs, this being your rookie year. What'd you do to actually save some money so you can make it this far?
I've run on a lot of used parts. I buy used tires, especially from competitors that race against me. I also work a little bit of overtime with my job. I wouldn't change anything I've done this year for the world. It's been a heck of a ride, and I'm just glad to be here.
Back on track, you're watching Joseph Gaudette right now, circulating around. It's great to be able to race the way that he's racing.
That is a huge commitment for a man to make, to take your street car, which is a very expensive street car at that, and then convert it to a race car, knowing that you can full and well lose the whole package.
Yeah, I've always said, if you want to go showroom stock racing or touring car racing in T1, T2, T3, you need to be willing to say, I can wad this up into a little ball and leave it in the garbage can at the racetrack, because you have to face those realities, but right now he's doing a great job.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Like I say, it's a huge commitment for a person to make because those bad things do happen in racing.
And it's got to stay in the back of your mind when you're mixing it up out there as well, going, hey, this thing needs to stay in one piece.
Of course, we used to drive our race cars from home to the racetrack and then race them and drive them back sometimes.
Yeah, big moment for us, but let's talk a little bit about the takeaway from the 2012 season. Naturally, we expect Red Bull, Ferrari, McLaren, and the like will be back and tougher next year, but so many questions. What will Mercedes have with Lewis Hamilton alongside Nico Rosberg? And what a moment for Nico Hülkenberg as he prepares to join the Sauber team.
Yeah, I feel sorry for Nico. I really think he should be the guy that's going to be driving the McLaren. I'm sure McLaren next year are going to be very, very strong. I can't believe that Ferrari aren't going to make some sort of a comeback after this year. And of course, Red Bull with Adrian Newey, who is absolutely the key man in any team at the moment, still looking very strong for next year. So I think 2013 should be a very exciting year.
Absolutely titanic battle right through 2012. Amazing performance by all at Red Bull and Renault. Yes, they had their hiccups with reliability problems on the alternators, but when it mattered, they did bring the car home. They locked out the Constructors' Championship, $300 million plus in 3 years in terms of prize money. That will all fund the 2013 car. They were back in force. And, of course, the two big names in Formula One we always talk about, McLaren, Mercedes, they want it more than anything else. And, of course, Ferrari, they would love to take the Constructors' Championship next year. So going into 2013, it's going to be an absolutely phenomenal battle for success in Formula One.
The sad thing is, I mean, obviously at the end of any season is very emotional for the teams down there. We've known that. We've seen the emotion in, for instance, Felipe Massa. They'll all be going out to have a very good time tonight. But for us in particular, this is a very sad moment too. 16 years with Speed Vision morphing into Speed, and this is our last ever race on Speed, which is going to be very sad for all of us, I'm sure, especially you, Bob, who won't be following Steve and me along to NBC next year, which we're very lucky to be doing. And it's been great working alongside you. It's 23 years since we did our first Formula One drive race together, and we've always just had the greatest time, and we've seen some fantastic racing over those years, there's no doubt about it. And of course, it was great when Steve came along to replace me when I went off to do Le Mans, and you came and never went away again. Still there.
You couldn't get rid of me. You couldn't get rid of me. Well, I mean, I have to say, working with Speed Vision and Speed Channel and Speed over the last 13 years for me has absolutely changed my entire life. I've worked for two Formula One teams, got great success in the pit lane with Benetton, won the Constructors' Championship there, which was the height of my career in the pit lane working with Benetton, and now working with everybody at Speed has been an absolutely phenomenal experience. And as I say, quite literally, it has changed the course of my entire life. I'm now fully focused, really, on having a fun time in the United States, and I don't want to go, really. I love being in America, and I love, absolutely love, bringing Formula One to a very, very enthusiastic audience that has watched us over the last 13 years.
Well, Steve has always been very keen to point out that Formula One is a team sport. Everybody matters, from, as Bob says, the lowliest mechanic pushing a beam to, of course, the driver. And certainly with Speed and Speed Vision, the team has been absolutely paramount. We've had great directors, great producers, and a great backup team from everybody here, from Frank Wilson right down through the group. And it's been a marvelous time working for Speed. And it's going to take some, they've set a very high bar to take over. There's no doubt about it.
At the beginning of the show, we saw you and Sam welcoming that first Speed Vision audience 296 Grand Prix races ago. Did you ever dream we'd be here today?
I didn't. You're right, Bob. It's absolutely incredible, really. 290 races has been absolutely fabulous. I've enjoyed every minute of it. And as I say, what a wonderful team Speed has been. And it's so sad to see them breaking up now, not doing the races anymore.
Well, all things change, and now it's time for us to change as well. And I'd just like to say, David, it's been a great ride. Steve, thanks to you. We'll call Will Buxton home. We'll chat with him. Look for the final edition of Formula One Debrief coming up next weekend. It's been a great ride. And now I'd like to take a small moment to say a few words. It's a moment that I really hoped would never come. Next year, as David mentioned, Formula One moves to a new broadcast home here in the USA, ending Speed's 17-year run, as you know. It also ends a long partnership with my fellow announcers, David, Steve, and Will, who will follow Formula One to its new network while I continue my career here at Speed. My thanks to all of you out there for all the kind words on social media, recalling all of the race weekends around the world we've shared in the last decade and a half or so. The future for Grand Prix racing here in America, I think, looks bright with a great new event in Austin, Texas, and a second planned for New Jersey in 2014. Like you, I'll be watching. We'll leave you today with a look back at the past 17 seasons. It's been a great ride. And now, for the final time, for David Hobbs, Steve Batchett, Will Buxton, Sam Posey, and all who've worked on our Speed Formula One team, I'm Bob Varsha. So long, everyone.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sam Posey, and with me is David Hobbs. And the two of us, would like to welcome you to the debut of Formula One on Speed Vision.
I'm Bob Varsha, and let me start by saying how proud all of us at Speed Vision are to be bringing you this historic race.
Joining me once again, as he did for yesterday's live coverage of qualifying, former Benetton Grand Prix mechanic turned journalist and author, Steve Matchett.
Bob, thanks very much for inviting me back. Yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
This is Bo Derek, so we interview her.
I'm absolutely amazed to meet you, Bo.
And like David Hobbs on a Saturday night, the event is subject to blackout.
McLaren don't share the same problems that Williams and Ferrari have had to some extent. That was Simone, his girlfriend.
If she played a card right, she could be my girlfriend.
Hello, I'm Derek Daly.
She said if I cozied up to her, she would talk to me. And she looks lovely, very Formula One.
Kimi Raikkonen didn't have bad luck. He wouldn't have any luck at all. I mean, it is uncanny, the stuff that goes wrong with this man's cars.
Here's Raikkonen telling all the boys on the boat exactly what happened.
He's my hero.
Welcome back to David Hobbs' used car lot.
He looks about like my cat does when I give it a big hand like that.
Extreme psychological problems, but look at that. The British Marshal's doing a terrific job.
Just leave me alone. I know what to
do. I'm in America, baby.
Carnage everywhere. Red flag destroys most of the field here.
Nobody is going to stop him. Look at this.
What? Oh. He takes it. Oh, come on.
Around the outside. Wow. He is the ball.
Oh.
And the checker's out. Now, who is that going to balk? Who's blown up?
It's a Ferrari. Ferrari.
The Ferrari is stopping. Wheel to wheel.
You win. Yes. He
wow.
does it.
Oh, man. Oh, huge wow. crash. Kubica.
Oh. Oh. Sending boys, you've got that Lewis is right behind.
You don't think Alonso's playing mind games with Hamilton here, do you?
Oh, round.
Keep going.
Oh, he's beached it. Stuck.
He's beached it.
You can't do that. You're Lewis, you can't let him by. Can this be happening?
It's over, boys. It's over.
For the lead. The
Oh, no.
Wow.
That is Mark Webber has gone over.
Fantastic guys, stop there for number two driver, please. Fernando is faster than you.
There it is.
Oh, boy.
There it is.
That's a bit brazen.
Oh, he got spun. That's Hamilton. He got sideways. Oh. And Romain Grosjean and Fernando Alonso.
I'm beginning to think that that's the official anthem for Formula One racing.
It's about to be linked with Ferrari for always in the record books. As Michael Schumacher wins, and it's Damon Hill's moment here. At long last.
Contact, this is the battle, but they may have contacted.
He is the 1997 Formula One world champion.
Finland has another world champion.
The first from his nation to drive for Ferrari, and now he picks up that long-awaited first career win.
41st victory, which puts you equal second all-time with Ayrton Senna. Do those records mean a lot to you?
Yes, it does mean a lot to me.
But Michael Schumacher in the Ferrari as the flags wave and the crowd cheers will win the U.S. Grand Prix at Indianapolis. Schumacher will win the race and with it the world championship for Ferrari, the first since Jody Scheckter in 1979.
Kimi Raikkonen in Malaysia has been in a class of his own.
Fernando Alonso, he'll take the checkered flag to become the youngest Formula One winner in history.
Six cars and six cars only will take the start of the sixth United States Grand Prix at Indianapolis.
What a farce.
It's all about Fernando Alonso Diaz of Spain, who comes through to become Spain's first ever Formula One world champion. His 90th career win and perhaps his final one at Monza for Ferrari.
I've decided together with the team that I'm going to retire from racing.
Victory for the first time in his career to Lewis Hamilton of McLaren Mercedes. In the most improbable of ways, Kimi Raikkonen of Finland will win the 2007 Formula One Championship for Ferrari. And now a new page is written as 21-year-old Sebastian Vettel wins his first Formula One victory and the first for his team. Felipe Massa has done everything he needed to do to win the World Championship, but it's not over yet. That's Timo Glock. That's Timo Glock.
Wow, he's done it.
And he will come from behind to claim the world title.
Racing gods are just playing with us.
We are the champions, the
best. The
youngest world champion in history and Abu Dhabi Grand Prix winner Sebastian Vettel of Red Bull Racing.
Think of Formula One as a merry-go-round, a sort of carousel. 17 years ago, it stopped for us to climb aboard. We had no idea then how long our ride was going to be. But as the years went by, we began to hope it might never end. Well, now it has, and it's time to say goodbye. Many fans shared the ride with us. Our thanks to each of you for coming along. We had a lot of fun together, don't you think?
Get ready.
It's Pure Michigan 400. Joey Logano is the 45th driver to win a pole here, and he has just run the ninth fastest pole lap of all time in NASCAR.
Yeah, there's amazing speed out of all these first 10 cars. Just a great day of qualifying.
Logano and Kurt Busch will share the front row here at Michigan on Sunday ahead of Jimmy Johnson, Mark Martin, and the rest of the field. For 18 years, it's been our honor and privilege to present motorsports, an automotive-related program to you on the network that began as Speed Vision, became Speed Channel, and is now known as Speed. From the visionaries who started this network, from maintenance to management, from the talent to the truck drivers, we've shared your passion for motorsport over these many years. We love that you care as much about your cars as family, God, and country, and so do we. But now, it's time to switch off the ignition and turn in the keys. This is the end of Speed in America. We hope you'll follow us on our new journey to Fox Sports 1, because all your favorite live NASCAR programming and much more is coming along with us. So now, it's good night and farewell to America's motorsports authority, Speed.
Good morning, and welcome to the very first day of Fox Sports 1. Here on America's new sports network, our promise to you is that we will share your passion for the game, never take ourselves too seriously, and most importantly, never put ourselves above the game nor the athletes. We will be informative without ever sacrificing accuracy. We work for you, the fan, and every day we will live up to this simple promise. Now, let's get on with the show.
The 2012 season ended with the Crimson Tide hoisting the Crystal Trophy. Now, a new season is here.
We are back on a very special edition of NASCAR Race Hub, as today we honor the life and legacy of our friend and colleague, Steve Burns, who today lost his battle with cancer at the age of 56.